So the main thing is that we can slice that way, which is what we're seeing here. So this is called an axial scan. And we can slice this way, which is called a sagittal scan. And the point is that with each of them, we can then go up and down and left to right. So that's kind of what you see on a scan. It's important also to say that, you know, when you're in a scan, there'll be noise for a few minutes and then a gap, noise, and a gap. And those are different sequences being collected. And what we mean by that is the MRI settings are changing in such a way that you're getting at a particular thing. It gives, so each sequence is good at picking up specific abnormalities. So for MS, we're interested particularly in three. So one of them is called a T2, and another one is called a flare. And those are the ones for detecting lesions on scan. So we'll come back to what lesions really mean. So on standard kind of NHS strength scanners, then a T2 will pick up just over 60% of lesions, and a flare will pick up just over 70%. So this is a flare on this side here, and these are the eyes. So the patient is looking upwards, and effectively their body and then their legs are coming out of the scanner like this. And so at the bottom of the brain, we work our way upwards. And what we're looking for in a flare are little white lesions that would suggest MS. Not specific for MS, but in keeping with it. So for example, here and here, there's little bits as well there, there, there and there. And just, you'll see little ones that I probably haven't pointed to on the way up as well. So that's the main purpose of doing an MRI scan, is to identify the lesions, and those are the main sequences we do. The other sequence that we routinely do is after the injection of gadolinium, so the contrast agent. And that's because if a lesion is new, about 4 weeks old, then that gadolinium will light up on the scan, and therefore it can help us to age a lesion. There's two main uses for how an MRI is used in diagnosis. The first, which is often the one that we don't think about, but we really should, is looking for other causes. MS, how people with MS present is not specific. It can be a number of different conditions. So the first thing is they have different MRI appearances. So rule out other conditions. And then the second thing is to do with fulfilling the criteria and making the diagnosis as early as possible. So as you know, most people with MS present with relapsing remitting MS, so about 85%. And the other 15% will present with a primary progressive disease where there's no relapses but gradual worsening from the beginning. So first of all, in relapsing remitting MS, it used to be that people would need to have their first symptoms and then later on new symptoms in a different place and therefore giving different symptoms. And so, and that is really the crux of how we diagnose MS, saying that there's spread of in time and spread in space. But we now know that the earlier we start treatments, the better the long-term outcomes. So therefore we want to be able to diagnose it before waiting for another set of symptoms. So the criteria say to us, well, actually you can use an MRI scan to prove that there's evidence of MS in different places, therefore lesions in different places, but also you can use the MRI scan to show that there's spread in time. For example, if you do on one scan, you find lesions that enhance and lesions that do not enhance, well, that says that there are new and old lesions respectively. And similarly, if you repeat a scan and show there are new lesions, then we know there's old and there's new lesions. So more recently, lumbar punctures have been used to help fulfill that time criteria, but that's another thing. So we've talked about proving it's MS, how to diagnose and the criteria for relapsing remitting MS, And for those with progressive disease from onset, primary progressive MS, again, you need an MRI scan to fulfill the criteria. So a lesion, if I just pull up one of these guys again, so if we take this chap here, every one of those lesions has got a little vein in the center. And it's quite a good way to think about what's actually happening in MS. So that vein, out of it leaks inflammation. And therefore, that's the first component of a lesion. When that inflammation happens, the nerves, which normally have a layer of insulation on it called myelin, the myelin comes off. So the second component of a lesion is demyelination, the loss of that myelin. And the third component is that nerve has then been left there exposed. And so not only has the myelin come off and therefore it's not functioning and that's led to symptoms, but also that nerve needs the myelin to feed it, to support it. So with time, there can be nerve loss or nerve death. So actually a lesion is a combination of inflammation, demyelination, and nerve loss. So can we see every lesion? No. So we mentioned that using standard strengths of scanner that we use in the NHS, a minimum of 60% of lesions that we've seen on T2 and 70% on flare. Even at the highest power scanners, which we don't really use in NHS practice, what we call 7 Tesla scanners, you can only see up to 85% of lesions. So sometimes there will be lesions that we just can't see on a scan. So we won't see all of them. The last component, and this is more a research component, is that we've always thought of MS as being a white matter disease, meaning, actually, on this scan, it's the other way around, but this tissue in the middle, despite it being darker here, is white matter. The outer bit is called grey matter. And there, using these kind of scans, we only see about 5% of lesions in the grey matter. So no, we certainly don't see all lesions. A lot of people ask us, I'm feeling worse, my symptoms are gradually worsening, but the scan is unchanged. How do we explain that? MS is more than just lesions. That's the kind of the take home. So we've said that not all lesions are visible first, but there's other processes going on as well. So you'll hear the word atrophy being used, and what that means is shrinkage of the brain. So looking at one scan alone is really hard to make a call on that. There are some fancy computer ways to do it, but broadly, it's very difficult. And what we'd see with lots of atrophy is bigger gaps in these, or bigger spaces here in these bits, which are called sulci. That reflects loss of nerves. So atrophy is one thing. The other thing is that even though the tissue around the lesions looks normal, in fact we call it normal appearing tissue, it's not normal. And there are some new ways of actually assessing the kind of integrity of that tissue. So when people say their symptoms are worsening, it isn't a surprise to us just because we can't see lesions. We know there are other symptoms going on. But what we do know is that most of the drugs we currently use in MS, the immunomodulatory drugs, do best in those who have evidence of new lesions, because they are targeting inflammation, and lesions are a feature of inflammation. Whereas the shrinkage, atrophy, and the abnormalities in the normal appearing tissues, those are indirectly related to inflammation, but are likely to reflect a more complex process that does not respond to these drugs. Is atrophy just MS? And the answer is no. With age, our brains do shrink. It's at a much slower rate. So what we also know is that as people have MS for longer, the rate of atrophy increases, and it is greatest in people who have progressive disease. But one of the most important messages here is that there is a big difference between what a person looks like who has MS and what the scan looks like. And that is across all of these abnormalities we're mentioning. People can have hundreds of lesions and have very little in the way of symptoms, and vice versa. And people can have lots of atrophy and minimal symptoms. But what we know is at a kind of a group level, if we take an average of people who have lots of lesions compared to few lesions, they will have more symptoms, they will have more disability. And that is the same with atrophy. The more atrophy there is, the more disability there will be. But because of that overlap between the groups, you can't say for one person with a disease, you can't predict what their symptoms will be or what the future is going to hold for them. It's a really good question. And broadly, we try to encourage people to take ownership of their disease. It's a really good marker for us of someone who's going to engage well, who's going to, you know, keep up on top of MS research. This is one example where it can be harmful. And the reason for that is that if they haven't seen a neurologist yet, then by definition, a non-neurologist has ordered that scan. And the radiologist, the doctor who reports the scan, can only do that on the basis of the information they've got. So a neurologist will be able to, to kind of go back a step, to make the diagnosis, you talk to the patient, you examine the patient, and then you interpret the scan in light of that. The radiologist has to rely on what they're told. So if I was a patient and I had been given a scan report that said in keeping with multiple sclerosis or demyelination, I would take that with a pinch of salt until a neurologist has seen it. And that's because, for example, these lesions on a scan, they can happen in 10 to 15% of people who do not have MS. And that's young people. As we get older, that number increases, such that over the age of 50, the majority of us have those lesions, even though we don't have MS. So it's really important to kind of get the context right. The second thing is that if there's an incidental finding on a scan, then we need to give that context too. So if someone has an abnormality of their blood vessels, an aneurysm, if someone has a benign growth, seeing that you have an aneurysm or a tumor on a scan report could be devastating. That could be, and usually would cause, a lot of unnecessary worry. If in fact either or both of those have been present since birth, are unlikely to change in the future and will cause no symptoms. So I think that's where having a neurologist can be very useful, rather than trying to interpret a report alone. There's a growing move, which is sensible. The idea here is that the drug is there to modulate the misbehaving immune system. It's there to try and get it back in check. It takes a little while to kick in. For example, there's some recent studies showing that particular drugs can take up to 9 months until it has an effect on some clinical measures. So the majority will be at their full effect within 3 to 6 months. So therefore, the recommendation is that when you've started a drug, you repeat the scan to act as a new baseline. We expect there to be a new blob or two in that period of time, and that's okay because the drug hasn't taken effect yet. What it means is that in the future, if you have a relapse, if you have new lesions, it lets us see whether they happened on drug and therefore indicate the drug is not holding the disease, or whether there's nothing new, in which case things are going well. this goes back to the previous question. At a group level, meaning if you look at 100 people with a lesion, for example, in the spinal cord or in the lower part of the brain, then there is a higher chance of later disability compared to a lesion higher up in the brain. Does that mean that as one person who has a lesion in their cord or in the lower part of their brain, that they are going to have a worse outcome? No, it doesn't. It's just averages. So I wouldn't pay too much attention to that. I think we know in the same way that the more lesions people have and the more atrophy people have, then there is a greater chance of disability in the future. But it is this difference between what the patient looks like and what the scan looks like means that you just can't say for an individual patient. It's important to say that. I think at the beginning, there are some markers that are quite helpful. But after that, there's too much kind of noise and variation to make any useful individual predictions. So this is a thorny issue, and it's thorny because we don't really have data. So in the UK, there are no guidelines that specify the frequency. In general, if we're talking about when if you've had one episode but you haven't fulfilled the diagnostic criteria, then an MRI scan could be useful. And it's generally performed 6 to 12 months later, because if that shows a new lesion in a different space, then that fulfills the criteria for MS. Outside of that is usually a question of monitoring. So in people who are not on treatment but are eligible for them, there's no really good evidence. But it would be appropriate to do a regular scan for a period of time. Of course, every time we order a test, we have to think, why are we doing it? And if, for example, a person with MS says, I don't want to go on treatment, I'm not going to go on treatment, even if I find new lesions on a scan, well, we should be pragmatic about whether doing that scan is appropriate. The other aspect is, what about people who are on treatment, who've had their re-baseline scan at 3 to 6 months? Going forward, how often should we scan those people? Well, in some countries it's done annually. In some centres in the UK it's done annually. Locally, it varies by clinician, and I think there should be a conversation between the person with MS and with the neurologist, because there's a lot of variation. If you're on a moderately effective treatment, then a new lesion might indicate that a treatment change would be appropriate. But if you're already on the highest efficacy drug and you find a new lesion, well, it's challenging to think what you're going to do with that. So in environments of confined resources, you have to think through, how is this going to influence care or improve care for this particular person?